Good day, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the SMI webinar on Artificial Intelligence for Port Applications. My name is Jacqueline from the Singapore Maritime Institute. Before we commence the exciting presentations which we have lined up for you, I would like to first invite Dr. Sanjay Kutan, Executive Director of SMI, to say a few words of welcome. Dr. Sanjay, please.
Jacqueline, I can't get my video on. The host has stopped it. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another session, webinar session that SMI is organizing. As you know, we've been doing this to bring research and development closer to industry. And with the advent and proliferation of the digitalization efforts across the maritime sector, we thought this webinar was particularly apt because the end game cannot be just the deployment of sensors and gathering of data. The end game must be about using the data for greater insights and decision making. And whilst it's easier said than done, I think the discussion today will show the opportunities about from AI and the use of data, and also the challenges. And we hope that the spread of researchers and industry folks that are presenting and later on the panel will give you all a sense of where we lie in our progress towards fully exploiting data through AI, and how we can better do it more efficiently and extract as much value from it. So I leave you to a great afternoon ahead, and Prof. Chu will be leading the panel, moderating the panel, and I'm sure do stay until the panel discussion, and please pose your questions. Thank you very much again for supporting SMI, and over back to you, Jacqueline.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. Before we commence the presentations, please allow me to briefly run through some housekeeping and administrative matters. Kindly note that this webinar will be recorded. Only the mics of the presenters and panelists will be turned on during the session. Only the presenters can share their screen during the webinar. There will be a panel discussion following the presentations, and we welcome audience to submit your questions to the panelists using the Q&A tab, which is located at the bottom of your screen. Today's panel discussion will be moderated by Professor Chu Ik Ping, Center Director of the Center of Excellence in Modeling and Simulation for Next Generation Ports. May I now invite Prof. Chu to say a few words and to help us introduce the first presenter. Professor Chu, please.
Okay, good afternoon. Welcome again to the webinar on Artificial Intelligence for Port Applications. My name is Chu Ik Ping, and I will be the facilitators for today's webinar. Today, we are honored to have four speakers who will share their experiences and research in the application of AI in ports. So our speakers are Dr. Li Haobin from the Center Excellence in Modeling and Simulation for Next Generation Ports, Dr. Fu Siu Ju from Institute of High Performance Computing, Mr. Goh Kwan Heng from NCS Private Limited, and Dr. Satya Muti from PSA Singapore. We hope through this webinar, you will be able to have a glimpse on the extent of AI being applied in the maritime industry and its potential value. So without further ado, we will start with the first speaker, Dr. Li Haobin. Dr. Li is the Chief Technology Officer at the Center for Excellence in the Modeling and Simulation for Next Generation Ports, and a senior lecturer at the National University of Singapore. His research is in discrete event simulation modeling and simulation-based optimization with application on maritime and logistics industries. He is leading a team of IT and research staff to develop an in-house digital twin for ports. He has successfully implemented several important application projects in collaboration with various government agencies and industry partners. His presentation today is on simulation with learning and optimization. three carriages driving the development of intelligent digital twin for port applications. Dr. Lee, please.
Okay. Sorry, I cannot share my video. Okay, thanks, Prof. Chu. I'm Haobin from NUS, and now I'm currently leading a team of developers in civil and GP working on the smart digital twin for maritime, port, and logistics applications. From our experience, I would like to take these opportunities to briefly talk about our understanding on artificial intelligence. Specifically, I would like to discuss the roles of simulation, how it works together with other AI ingredients such as learning and optimization in the development of the smart digital twin that we are working on for port applications. To do so, please allow me to first recap on the recognition of these three important AI ingredients, which is simulation, optimization, and learning, about what are their respective functionalities, advantages, and limitations. Following that, I will talk about their extensions to the smart digital twins, new research and development opportunities emerge from it, and the methodology and the solution approach we introduced and proposed, including how we can collaborate across the different organizations and domain experts while achieving our goals. When talk about AI, many people would straight away link with the data analytics and the machine learning. Well, I have to say that this is only one of the ingredients for AI, although it is important and most fundamental. In a narrow sense, learning could just refer to the analysis to obtain rules from the data and use it to predict or guide the decisions. It is fast to use once the training process is done, which gives it advantage to be applied for real-time scenarios. However, the limitation is also obvious, as it depends on the training data, which can only be collected from the past and not guaranteed to be resulted from the best actions. Consider one counter example that we will need to find out the best terminal design for our future container port. So purely relying on the learning approach will definitely fail. This is why we have to bring the optimization into the picture, to look for the maximum performance a system could achieve in the future, beyond what we can observe in the past. While we are doing so, we are not only interested in how a system behaves, but also what is the internal structure and mechanism that drives the systems into such behaviors. Because only if we know such mechanism, we are able to reason out behaviors that never occurred in the historical data. Then you could start to feel why simulation is important. It provides us a scientific way to characterize a system by describing the internal structure and mechanism in a quantitative manner and meanwhile make it close to the reality. While an optimization modeling is oriented by how a problem is to be solved, a simulation modeling first focuses on what the system is, because only then we should be able to identify the real problem and discuss the most proper way to solve it. Talking about the three AI ingredients work together, we could see that there is a long-term friendship between the learning and optimization, whereas simulation seems to be a stranger or newcomer who usually acts by itself or validation or demonstration purpose after the main job was done by these two friends. For example, learning itself can be seen as optimization, that is to minimize a prediction error. Or for a specific application, learning process can be optimized by selecting from the different learning models or corresponding parameters. For the purpose of optimization, we can have a learning approach to predict a search area for better solutions, or alternatively, or most recently, we can have the learning from the optimization results under various scenarios so that learning is no longer only from the past, and optimization has much more time to prepare for better solutions before scenario realized in real time. One good example is AlphaGo. Nobody could deny that there is a significant optimization components in the reinforcement learning, and it demonstrates that the friendship between the optimization and the learning indeed created an impactful milestone in the history of AI. However, many people may ignore that there is an indispensable place for the younger brother simulation. Without simulating the chessboard and the Go game between the two virtual players, the AlphaGo could never know which strategies performs better under scenarios that never occurs in human history. The contribution of the simulation seems to be invisible, and all glories are taken by the optimization and the learning simply because the rule and the mechanism of the Go game is too simple compared with the scenario and the decision space of the problem, which is tremendously large. But what if we would like to transplant such AI technologies into maritime and port operations? Can we still say that the simulation modeling is a trivial problem? I believe the answer is obvious. The simulation is growing up and turns out to be equally important compared to the other two big brothers in the AI family. We also need to take note that the roles of simulation is changing. As it grows up, simulation is no longer standalone, as only for validation and demonstration, but starts to have more interactions with the two big brothers in the AI family. Beyond acting as a decision verification platform, simulation could also be used as a realistic and a formal problem description, as well as the virtual deduction environment for an AI algorithm to observe the system behaviors. To summarize, in near future, simulation is no longer only communicating with the human beings, but it requires the capability to talk with the optimization, learning, and other components in the AI family so as to establish an entire ecosystem, which we could refer it as a smart digital twin. This is how the whole family looks like. We have the simulation to address the fidelity of the system description, problem definition, and evaluation, while the working together towards a higher level analyzability, optimization and the learning is responsible to find out the in-time solutions with sufficient speed and accuracies. At the same time, other AI components will ensure that the solution can be synchronized on timely with the physical machines and communication well with the human operator and the stakeholders, so as to ensure that we as human beings are still in control. Several new research problems can be addressed from here. For example, how a simulation modeling should be done targeting to interface with not human modeler, but optimization and the learning algorithms, and how a simulation-based optimization should be conducted if there are multiple scenarios to explore, multiple objectives to take care, and there are multiple models available with different fidelity levels. And also, how different will be the machine learning if the training data can be actively generated from the simulation and optimization process compared to the conventional cases where the data can only be passively observed from the history. These are all the research topics our university team is trying to find a solution. And beyond this, we're also working with our industrial collaborators to look at some engineering development issues, such as how the digital twin can be implemented with the latest computational infrastructure, and how we could use the latest IoT and visualization technologies to enable a real-time decision-making. As you may already know from our previous events, we have developed the ODES framework to allow a simulation to be seamlessly integrated with optimization and learning in different ways. And more than this, we have also investigated conventional simulation modeling theory and adopted an event-based kernel in our ODES framework to support a high fidelity and precision as required in many port planning and operation problems. On top of it, to tackle the large-scale systems as we encounter in simulating our mega container port, we apply a state-based approach to wrap up groups of events into subsystem modules. And with this hierarchical modeling approach, we could systematically construct the port components at different layers and assemble them on demand to analyze the respective problems faced by our industrial collaborators, which includes a capacity analysis of a new port terminal, planning of AGV transponders, and the traffic in the construction of the new terminals. As we are moving our focus from planning to the problem in the operational phases, it becomes more important to understand the flow of entities in the maritime port, such as containers, vehicles, equipment, or even passengers and luggage, as in the recent project we're working with the ferry terminals. Therefore, we have further extended our ODES framework to support an activity-based modeling approach, which we call it RCQs or resource constraint queues. As all simulation modeling approach we adopted or developed are rigorously defined, systematic, and self-contained, we're not only training our center staff and NUS students to learn such approach, we're also developing a software tool that is able to build the port simulation model through a markup language, which we call the port ML. And eventually, we would like the AI algorithm to be able to master such language so that the simulation, optimization, and the learning could join together and serve us better for the port community in Singapore. By working together, the AI in the port system could tell us how to make optimal decision under different future scenarios, how to make a best choice from a set of candidate solutions once the scenario is realized. What will be the impact if the certain decision is made and implemented under a future scenario, and what could we observe in the near future if we know what has just happened in the past? You can see that there are many possibilities we can achieve in the future. And clearly, there is no single organization who is able to complete all the work in one shot. We have to create a synergy to get the different universities, research institutes, companies, or government agencies from different countries to work together. We could establish a set of compatible standards. We could form an open community or build an open platform for developing various simulation modules and AI algorithms. And the end application could be enjoyed by such rich library, and the developers could be benefited from receiving the license fee from the end users and use it as a financial support for their future research and development efforts. We know that this could be just a dream that takes us years or decades to explore whether it is workable. However, with the development of the Port Digital Twins and the establishment of the Port ML Alliance, we as a civil NGP of NUS has already made the first step towards this dream for the maritime and the port communities. Hope you could join us. And with this, I will end my short presentation today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Harbin, for your interesting talk. So the next speaker is Dr. Fu Siuju. Dr. Fu is senior scientist and group manager in Institute of High Performance Computing at A*STAR. Her research is in the system modeling, big spatial temporal data analytics, simulation and optimization, and the applications in complex systems management. She has led a team for problem solving across multiple domains, including maritime, supply chain, and public health systems. For maritime area, she led multiple projects for studying port operation efficiency and traffic safety, leveraging on high performance computing based techniques. Her presentation today is on artificial intelligence modeling for maritime operation efficiency and traffic safety enhancement. Dr. Fu, please.
Thanks, Prof. Chiu. Now allow me to share my slides. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, SMI, for organizing this interesting event and inviting me to give this speech. So I'm Siuju from Institute of High Performance Computing. So in this talk, I will first introduce our institute. Then I will give a brief recovery about air applications in maritime and the challenge we are facing. And after that, I will show some examples how HPC team is applying AI in some maritime applications. So HPC is one of the research institutes and the agency for science, technology, and research. So we have more than 300 researchers, more than 85% are PhD researchers. So our institute excel in multidisciplinary modeling, simulation, and AI. The capability is laying in seven research departments. So I'm from this system science department. So it's across system enhancement and go to fluid dynamics and even the social cognition. So if we talk about AI, so this is a very hot topic. And when we talk with friends or industry player or partners, so if you don't mention AI, it sounds like you are not at the front end of the technology. So as in many other sectors, AI have been funding we are funding the AI applications in maritime. That's quite a lot of applications. So it's partially is promoted by this automation and the digital transformation. So we can find that the sensors and the Internet of Things help promote the data availability and the application for AI. And also, because like AIS is openly available, you can purchase from there somewhere. So this kind of data's availability also help the researchers and the industries to put a lot of AI trials and have a lot of applications. And we can also fund in many other applications. Although this AI have been explored in maritime, we would say that the development is still at the a little bit early stage. So I think the challenge we are facing lies in around the five parts. I just highlight some of them here. So definitely first one is about the data availability. So it's most of the data are located in individual entities' own hardware. So how to share or reserve their privacy is a concern. So people might not be able to access the full amount of the data and get the full set of the information. That's one of the obstacles. Another one is when we're dealing with large scale data, computing cost and the hyperscale computing facilities is needed. Not every company is owning that. Also another one is we have AI models or systems. So whether it's trustable or the explainability is around, this also will impede some of the application development. And another one is if there are some negative consequences from AI applications, who will be responsible for that? So lack of the regulations to say who will be responsible from the bad results from AI or the lost. So some regulation may be needed to help AI to establish further in maritime, and I think it's also in other domains. So now let me show some examples how HPC is working to tackle with some of the challenge we are facing. So first, like we mentioned that a lot of data have some quality issues like AIS data here. And with error and missing data, it's a large volume of data. HPC team have developed this pre-analysis algorithm. It's able to deal with the error missing data and also can reduce the redundant information to only keep the essential information by reducing the total volume more than 400 times. So it can be used for long time implementation and development. So the figures also shows how we recover the missing chunk in the trajectories. So we give another example, like how this deep learning, which is with some memory about what happens in the past, how they can be applied in maritime. So this is for the traffic safety problem. So if you want to classify whether is a moving vessels is going to street or going to turn or going to have this avoidance behavior during the turn, if we transform this into a deep learning based classification problem, so this is the deep learning architecture we have. So we can input a different type of data and go to this network. So and we can achieve certain accuracy is quite promising, but still have space to improve. So a lot of efforts need to be done to make sure the quality of the data and the volume of data to be processed in the efficient and the correct way. So just now we mentioned that computing cost is a challenge. So HPC also, definitely we are the institute of hyperscale computing. So we have this hyperscale computing facility, also the capability. We develop our own in-house concurrent computing system to enable the utilization of the this kind of big size of data for different tasks. For example, for the trajectory prediction. So you need to take in a lot of historical trajectories from AIS data. And this middle part, we show one of the example, we forecast traffic hotspot to assist operators to sense the traffic situation ahead. So whether this 30 or 25 minutes ahead, you will face to a heavy traffic. So it will affect your decision, how you, the speed you are moving on, or how you will turn you know, more safely. So I think that this is one of the example of how we utilize hyperscale computing based AI for this maritime research. Yeah. So here we saw how this AI can be used for port operation related task. So here is one question we ask. If one vessel go to Singapore port or one fleet go to a port, no matter in Singapore or other port, so we want to know how well it operates. Or if we go to a certain port, how well this port is operate.
And sometimes this data is belong to individual entities, but the thanks for the AIS data's availability. So we developed this AIS-based operational events detection. So it means give the AIS data of those vessels of lead or the AIS data in the port, we can detect the historical operation events using cluster-based AI approach. So it's more a reactive machine, means they don't really have memory, but it can react based on the data to tell us the pattern, tell us some essential information. It can be done in real time also. It can give a long history of the data. We can detect the pattern. So it can be used for many ways. For example, you want to use the data for future prediction. If a vessel come to this port again, how long they will stay and so on. So this historical data, large amount of historical data need to be extracted through such kind of algorithm. So another example of the AI things or challenge we mentioned is the data scarcity and the data owned by individual entities. So, but if you read AI for AI, basically, if you have sufficient information, large volume data, actually they will give us a full intelligence out of the data. But if you just have a sparse set of data, then the accuracy won't be there. So this federated learning is a new paradigm from AI. So this can help us to solve the data privacy issue. So instead of asking individual companies to pass the data to a central server, the model will go to individual companies' server to train the model. Then only the model parameters will send to the central server to make the central models to learn in a global way to realize the better accuracy based on all the data, but you don't know individual data as their own details. So this can solve the concern from the industry for sharing their data, because even sometimes the data might not only belong to one individual entity. So you can see the applications in, for example, voyage optimization for vessels. So not one company can own all the CROs information, right? So if all the CROs from different companies can be combined, consolidated, and we can learn from there, then every vessel, when they go to the a new route or new situation, they can learn from the history and to get the optimal speed and the fuel consumption reduction. So and definitely can find other similar use case to be applied by using this federated learning paradigm. So in general, AI definitely is with a greater potential for its applications, although we foresee the challenge are there. But I believe with a lot of collaborations from different partners between academia and the industry players, we could find the bright future about AI application. And for HPC, actually, we have been developing Hermes computing-based AI approach and also considering the simulation, like Hobin just mentioned now. If you want to know the future scenario, which never happened before, so you can leverage our simulation to simulate the new scenarios for the system to enhance. And also, definitely, you can try a lot of the different scenarios to achieve the optimal design of the future operation process or even the system and so on. So for improving the computing efficiency, we also explore quantum computing. It's still at an early stage, but this will change the computing, helps computing dramatically, definitely. So we're also exploring towards this direction. We welcome the collaboration from industry for that. So HPC in the past few years have done a lot in the traffic safety and port operation efficiency kind of research. And in the recent 1-2 years, we also start embark our journey for the emission reduction, also the coordination between port and police operation, the navigation side. So there's a lot of opportunity by applying AI for Maritime's enhancement. So we hope we can see more of the collaboration with you, and have more of the discussion. So this is end of my sharing. Thanks for your listening.
Okay, thank you, Suju, for sharing some of your interesting AI applications in Maritime, especially on the federated learning that you have just now mentioned. It's quite interesting to have this kind of paradigm where companies have to come together actually to work and to share data so that actually you can be able to develop AI technology that is more efficient. Okay, so for the third speaker is Mr. Goh Kuan Heng. He is no stranger to many of us. Mr. Goh is currently industry lead transportation in NCS Private Limited, where he is responsible for developing strategies and provide top leadership to spearhead NCS smart port solutions to serve the maritime industry. He supports NCS customer service unit in enlightening clients on future industry trends and next generation technology, and co-creating new solution concepts with clients. Has 30 years of experience in the maritime industry. Prior to joining NCS Private Limited, he worked in the Maritime and Port Authority of Singapore, where he took several management portfolio. His presentation today is on smart port transformation with AI and analytics. Mr. Goh, please.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Prochu, for the introduction. So my presentation today is on the smart port transformation with AI and analytics. And this is the agenda of my presentation. Now, I would like to start with this overview slide on what I envisage the future port operations that will look like. So with digital revolution, there will be a lot of opportunities for port operators to leverage the new technology to better manage the operations while they continue to face new challenges. And some of these new challenges, include the need to address emerging shipping trend, such as more mega container ships calling at the hub port, the autonomous hovercraft, such as autonomous tugboat, remote piloting, as well as in the future, autonomous ship. And port like Singapore also face its own set of domestic challenges, such as the need to manage increasing shipping traffic with limited sea space and land space, and also shortage in the maritime manpower. So facing with all these challenges and the need to remain competitive, it is imperative for port operators to acquire new capability to enhance port safety, efficiency, and customer service. So for example, the next generation vessel traffic management system will need to have an analytics capability to better manage the vessel traffic. And it also need to have a two-way digital communication between ship and shore. Many leading ports are also looking into providing just-in-time arrival and services to minimize ship waiting time and to optimize marine resources. So the other trend, another trend is on the using marine drone to provide new services such as ship to shore delivery of goods, inspection of ships, and inspection of port equipment. So at the terminal side, the future operation is to achieve a fully automated operations where there will be minimum number of workers working in the terminal. So operations will be monitored remotely at the control center, and a human being will be deployed just to handle only operation exceptions. And lastly, port operators will also need to look at the sustainability issue. For example, smart grid, smart energy management in view of the global drive in decarbonization. So going forward, AI-powered or data-driven operations will be one of the key engines driving transformation in the port industry. And this slide will give you a clearer picture on how AI analytics can be applied in the respective areas of port operations. And from my observation, port operators are transforming themselves through four key trusts as shown on the slide. And all the capabilities under the four key trusts will need to be supported by different types of digital technologies. But I can see that many of these capabilities will involve the use of AI, IoT, big data, and analytics. So for example, on data-driven operations to enhance safety, the next generation vessel traffic system can deploy predictive analytics to predict ship ETA, possible near misses, and traffic hotspot. And AI and machine learning can also be applied in smart terminal planning, smart facility management, smart energy management. Right? For remote and autonomous operations, I can use AI in areas such as autonomous hovercraft operations, remote piloting, and remote ship inspection. And I believe smart sensors coupled with video analytics has already been deployed in the yard automation and AGV deployment. But to achieve a fully automated crane operations, I believe more intelligent sensors and algorithm will be required to meet the desired outcome. And so we can see that the big data analytics has a great potential to transform the port industry. The four dominant types of analytics, namely the descriptive, real-time, and predictive and prescriptive analytics are all interrelated solutions, helping companies to drive maximum value from the big data that they have. So for the maritime sector, each of these analytic types, for the maritime sector, each of these analytics types offer different kind of insight to port operators and the shipping lines as shown on the slide. And I've already given some example on how port operators can use analytics. So for the shipping lines, they can use predictive analytics to better predict their cargo space, demand, freight prices, and also prescriptive analytics to use it to optimize their shipping network to resolve empty containers problem, as well as to improve their profitability of their service routes. So for the next few slides, I just will highlight a few use cases on big data in the port operation areas. Use case number one is about how Port of Rotterdam use analytics to optimize their waterway management. So in this example, Port of Rotterdam have installed sensors across 42 kilometers of its waterway, spanning from the city of Rotterdam all the way up to North Sea. And these sensors will gather data such as the real-time tidal currents, temperature, wind speed, direction, berth availability, and turn them into information that a port authority can use to determine the optimal times for ship to dock, therefore enable more ships to come into the available space. So the Hamburg Port Authority, because they manage a lot of multimodal traffic in and out of the port, so their smart port initiative mainly is to use data analytics to help optimize traffic and cargo flow and to achieve effective maintenance of the port infrastructure. The third use case is about shipping line OOCL using advanced analytics to help their customer better predict the ETA of their reefer containers. So you can see our customer will not only have the real-time location of the container at sea, but also predictive insights as to how changes to some of the variables such as vessel sailing patterns, terminal productivity, and carrier schedule performance may affect shipment schedule. Therefore, allowing customers to make well-informed decisions for their supply chain. And apart from the cargo visibility at sea, the system also provides similar visibility level when the shipment is moving on land by using IoT technology built into the container. Right, so by leveraging the power of AI, the system recommends the best routes and predict ETA to the destination using historical data and a real-time traffic situation. Now, this use case is about using analytics to help make chases, leasing, and selection policy. So in this case, the logistic company Schneider National need to carry out container drayage operations on a daily basis, which is a process of transporting goods over a short distance. So basically, when a customer cargo arrive at the port facility, a chassis The containers will be placed on the chassis for transport to and from the transloading facility, which is not too far from the port. The operational challenge faced by the company is on the acquisition and management of these chassis, meaning that the business users want to know how many chassis should be leased for the whole year versus how many should be rented on a daily basis so as to optimize costs. So what they have done is that they develop a solution which leverage on a simulation, optimization, and machine learning to provide two decision points. First is the optimal fleet size for lease chassis, and second is a real-time decision policy for selecting between renter and lease chassis as containers are received. This is the last use case. It's about using analytics to provide situation awareness for a marathon event. Now, I know this is not a maritime use case, but I thought this is quite a useful use case to share so that we can learn from other industries as well. Now, Chicago Marathon is the second largest marathon in the world. So what this system does is to help the race organizer, the event manager, the volunteers, the public agencies to jointly plan and manage the race event. So the system uses historical and real-time data and also make use of the descriptive, predictive, and prescriptive models to solve their pain point. So this is a dashboard used displayed on a big monitor on the actual day of marathon for the organizer to view. So there are various information modules, for example, the weather module, the medical module display the number of patients who required hospital transport. And we have the runner modules display the number of runners have started, dropped, or finished the race. So on the left-hand side is the visualization display for course route. So runner density is expressed by color-coded mile segment, showing the number of runners within each mile. Now, the critical component in this system is the runner tracking simulation, which predicts the density of runners along the course using past and current runner and event data. So as the race evolves, the simulation responds dynamically as the real-time information comes in. So the simulation is able to accurately predict the current and future location of the runners. And this info is useful for effective resource deployment by the organizer. So this is applicable to maritime operations as well, be it for traffic, vessel traffic management or container traffic management or your supply chain logistic management, right? So nothing stopping us from creating our own situation awareness pictures in our respective area. So in conclusion, always align AI and analytics projects with a specific business goal. We have to bear in mind that there's no one-size-fits-all solution for AI applications. You need to determine what predictive modeling techniques are best for your own area. Use agile and iterative implementation techniques. Start small by identifying specific and high-value opportunities while not losing sight on the big picture. Last but not least, just to put everything in the right perspective, in enterprise AI system, usually the machine learning algorithm is only a small portion, probably like 5% of the entire system code. The required surrounding infrastructure is quite a lot and can be quite complex. And we need to pay attention to this area as well when we implement analytics and AI application in our organization. Yeah, so that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much. Back to you, Prof. Chiu.
Thank you, Kwan Heng, for a very interesting and insightful sharing, especially on all the use cases that we have presented. So before we introduce our final speaker, I would like to remind all the audience, if you have any questions that you want to ask, you can start sending your questions by typing your questions in the Q&A button. Okay, so the final speaker is Dr. Satyamurthy. Dr. Satyamurthy leads PSA Singapore's Insights and Analytics team comprising data insights analysts, data scientists, and data engineers. He has worked with PSA Singapore for more than 19 years and specialized in the area of data and operations research. His current focus is to introduce more data-driven decision-making in everyday operations processes, including deployment of AI, machine learning to solve business problems. His presentation today is on AI for port applications. Dr. Saya, please.
Thank you, Prof. Chu, the very generous introduction. And let me begin by congratulating SMI on their 10th anniversary. And this webinar, I understand, is celebrating that key hallmark event. And I also thank you for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts on this subject. And also to be able to listen in to what our industry and academic experts had to say. And in fact, I think a lot of you might be wondering, coming from the port operator or terminal operator's perspective, how many of these things am I really implementing or deploying? So in today's talk, I will briefly outline, I think, what I really understand by AI and how I want to scope it when I'm talking about AI. I know it's a very big subject and it can mean a lot of different things to different people. So I will just briefly touch on the scoping of the AI. And I will follow that up by very, very briefly touching on the port operations and also how port services are produced, who are the various stakeholders and what are the key factors. And from there, I will then go on to say, what are the different ways in which AI can manifest itself in these different areas of port operations? And so let me just begin with what I think AI is. I think very, very simply to define it is, it's just the machine's capability to, you know, imitate a human being. And I think some of the key ingredients you can see here, I'm not going to repeat things like how do we acquire the inputs, how do we sense, how do we process and reason around the inputs, and then arrive at decisions, and then actually take actions, because that is what really makes the difference. And then we are able to observe the outcomes and learn from them. So roughly, you could imagine a human also trying to, you know, evolve in this way, the human intelligence evolving in this way. The only thing with AI is that the hardware has improved rapidly, and I think that plays a big part in the current wave of AI as well. So here I'm just briefly trying to chart the progress of AI. I mean, what began as an idea in the 50s, I think there was always, a popular imagination of how machines could be intelligent and all that. But in about 50s or thereabout, AI as a term was coined. People came out with, you know, how you could reason with logic, with symbols and so on and so forth. And then there was another stream which tried to learn from experts. And the outcome was things like expert systems. And some of them we saw in commercial applications as well. All of them trying to mimic a human expert. And then I think the new wave of AI is really about learning from data. Previously, you could probably imagine as machines learning from experts. You know, people spell out the rules, describe different situations and say what you must do. But here now we are saying, I'm just giving you a lot of examples of how things work out. You go and learn from there. So that is possible now, I think, because a lot more data is being generated. And also, there is a lot of computing power to sift through the data, look at patterns, and so on and so forth. Now, all this is still, in a sense, very narrow AI, in the sense that the machines can become as intelligent, or even probably sometimes better than human intelligence. because of the capacity to process a lot of data and, you know, recommend decisions and so on and so forth. So, but it's still not able to solve a general kind of problem, which is what I mean by general AI. So that red line you see there is really about where the best human beings are there in terms of ability to crack problems, solve problems. So I think we are still some way away from there. And I think you can also imagine some kind of a super AI where, you know, it's really like a network effect. A lot of intelligent entities collaborate with each other to solve massive problems, which human beings cannot even think of, you know, cracking those kind of problems. Some of it is brute power and some of it is really raw intelligence as well. I must just mention here for the narrow AI part, I mean, Prof, you mentioned I'm also coming from an operations research kind of a background. So I do recognize there are optimization and simulation methods which also contribute in this area. And definitely at PSA, that is how we started off as well. We use a lot of optimization and simulation. Whether we call it AI or not, probably is another matter, but we do use them to solve problems. Yeah. So let me now come into how I can lay out the port operations and how the scope of our interest is also expanding over time. So if you look from left to right, you can typically see what happens at a container port. Might be similar at other kind of bulk ports as well. You see ships coming, cranes lifting containers on and off. You see horizontal transporters moving containers from the ship to the yard for temporary storage. You see yard cranes there to lift the containers from horizontal transport or put them back. And so this is the chain. And to the extreme right, you can see some of the containers moving in and out through the gate system. So now that is the container flow, which happens in a port like Singapore. And you can already see a lot of heavy equipment being used to handle the containers. Traditionally, when we started off, a lot of it was manually operated. Primary focus was on efficiently, safely, and in a secure way, move the containers in this process. I think a few things have happened recently. I think scarcity of maritime labor. So a lot more of these equipment are going through some kind of automation. That means you have fewer people operating these equipments or operating a pool of equipment. And some of these you can already see if you have visited our port in the past few years. And automation is one part. But then I think we are also looking at other stakeholders. I think gradually or even earlier as well, we used to work with the port community. And port community involves, you know, people like the haulage trucks, which bring the containers in and out of PSA to depots, to warehouses, and so on and so forth. Or it could involve shipping line agents, or it could involve, you know, provision of bunkering services. A lot of these people also own assets, which they also try to automate probably, or they also try to maximize the utilization. So it's also reaching out to them and how do we efficiently share info and share data so that everyone can better use the expensive and limited assets. I think that is an emerging area, and I think some of this we are also reaching out to cargo owners and not just shipping lines. Cargo owners is like people who own what is inside the laden containers. And some of them have needs in expediting the movement of cargo or making choices about where to store their cargo until they find a buyer and stuff like that. So there is scope to value add, and cargo solutions is one area where we see there is a lot of opportunity to value add as an emerging area. And I think some of the ways we have gone about that is to build platforms. and the platforms facilitate transactions, exchange of data, and also provides the basis to, you know, develop more data-rich applications. And I think the future, I think, is interesting because I think we are looking at playing our part in the global supply chains as key nodes. And I think one of the interesting areas which is going to come out over the next decade or so is being more environmentally sustainable, because that is what the world at large wants, what the shippers want, what the shipping lines are being forced to pay attention to. And so, of course, we will also be playing our part there. So I think that is one area. And the second one, I think, is basically, I just wanted to share how the port services are being produced. So I think you notice that there are a few key areas, a few key factors. I think at the center is basically, of course, the equipment fleet and the operators. But then we also use scarce land where our equipment are installed, where we stock containers, where we build roads for the containers to move and stuff like that. And the second one is we consume a lot of energy to operate the equipment. And I think we also rely on suppliers to provide part of the services. And then, of course, at the office side, we have a lot of planning and support staff who really work the processes, making sure all of these can be orchestrated and performed efficiently at scale day in, day out. And then finally, there is the ICT systems and algorithms, which provide the smart part of it, which really look at the data and, you know, enable the AI to, you know, come into play into a lot of these factors. And of course, at the center of it all is the customers. So let me then just move to the first example. I think one interesting area that we used AI, or where we are still rolling it out, is to improve the safety of workers who, you know, work on the ships to safely secure the containers before the ship leaves. So that is called lashing. And so as you can imagine, the workers are working in fairly hazardous circumstances, come rain or shine, and a very laborious process as well. And so we have got crane-mounted cameras which act as our eyes, and with intelligence, they can actually detect very quickly whether the operator is behaving safely or not safely. And so there is a reference kind of safe working practices, and the video analytics can really refer back to that and trigger alerts when something unsafe is spotted. Likewise, for the trucks which move around, we still got drivers. I mean, though the TUAS in future may have driverless systems, but we are also talking about autonomous trucks. But a large fleet is still driven by truck drivers. And of course, we have got sensors and camera as well to really look at the driver actions and feedback if there is any anomalies or unsafe behavior. So that is second. And the third one is on the operations of the equipment itself, where, again, there are plenty of sensors on the cranes for various reasons. But one of the uses is to look at how the equipment is being operated and whether we can see any abnormalities, which can help to improve how safely and properly the crane operators are operating their equipment. Second area of application for AI is really predictive crane maintenance. I think that is something which has kicked off over the past few years. We found our way after a few POCs, and now I think working with some external help as well, a lot of those crane sensor data has been blended with operations data and trying to correlate with failure data or abnormal behavior data to better forecast when the crane should be taken off operations and sent for maintenance. And that just-in-time kind of maintenance is very, very useful because it ensures the cranes are available when we need them, doesn't disrupt the port operations when the cranes are in high demand and stuff like that. It even helps us to plan for maintenance by securing spare parts, by provisioning the engineering resources to do the maintenance. I will probably not spend time on this part because automation generally involves a lot of sensors and video analytics, things like how to recognize a container number, how to recognize license plates, how to make sure the chassis is aligned and automated yard, how do you verify container weights, how do you identify a driver coming in through the gate system, stuff like that. I think the smart grid is also something spoken of by earlier speakers. And again, I think as we are big consumers of energy, there is a lot of opportunity to leverage on energy metering and power devices on the equipment to sense how the energy consumption is fluctuating, how the power demand is fluctuating. And with better forecasting, I think we can procure energy at better costs. We can optimize energy storage, and so we can manage the energy grid more optimally. And the final area I would want to cover is, I think, the most promising one, because this doesn't really involve equipment or hardware as such to handle the containers. It's really the software part of things. And this is really how do we plan the terminal activities. It acquires data from the terminal operating system, from our community systems like Portnet, from the various platforms we're creating to facilitate cargo solutions, or even data exchanges you might have read about in recent news. All of this provide a lot of data around which a lot of machine learning, deep learning, reinforcement learning can happen. And some of this is particularly exciting because you can somehow think of the terminal planning along the lines you would visualize AlphaGo or even like a game of chess. There is a need to look ahead, follow some rules, and learn from the outcomes on how to improve the planning. So that is a very interesting area for me personally. And I think specifically we are looking at things like how to better predict container dwell, how to predict the connectivity because we are a transshipment port, how do you predict yard activity levels, and all of this is supposed to help us to better plan the usage of scarce land. As you know, we got limited land area to stack our containers. So if you can do better of all this, I think we optimize our land usage and optimize our terminal facilities. I think other things I will also not dwell a lot because as been mentioned by previous speakers, like predicting the arrival of vessels, the throughput. This is really about understanding the customer behavior. The other one is really about forecasting the resources itself, forecasting manpower demand and supply. This is really about supplier behavior. Then really is about matching the supply to the demand and meeting the requirements of the vessels. And all the while we are trying to maximize the resource productivity and maintain the service levels. So I will just sum up. And I hope I'm trying to give a view which is different from the earlier speakers in the sense that they are trying to paint out the possibilities. And what I'm trying to do here is to say, where are the opportunities from a practitioner's perspective? Where do we feel the pinch? Where do we feel the needs? I think in summary is really about trying to better predict the behavior of various players, be they customers, be they our service providers, be it our algorithms, which provide these parts, predict the behavior of the equipment, predict the behavior of the operators and the workers. And with that, then try to look at the overall system and try to optimize it. And we focus our intervention where we think it pays off the maximum, because you don't want to apply a one-size-fits-all policy across the board. I think the AI and the data analytics is about micro-level decision-making. And every single decision, if it pays off well, it adds to the savings in cost, savings in labor, or delivery of better services. So with that, I will stop here. And I will be happy to answer any questions you may have. And you can also contact me anytime. I have shared my digital card here. And we'll be happy to hear from you and from the rest of the speakers as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Satya. And thank you once again to all the speakers for your very insightful presentations. We now move on to the interactive segment of the webinar, the panel discussion. And at this point, may I request for the moderator and all the panelists to please turn on your video. A gentle reminder to our audience to keep your questions rolling in by sending your questions through the Q&A button that's located at the bottom of your screen. Please be reminded to keep your questions concise and relevant to the presentation topic. And you may wish to direct your question to a particular panelist by indicating the name of the panelist in your question. You may also upvote any questions that interest you by giving a like through clicking on the thumbs up. So now I will now hand over the time to Professor Chu to moderate the panel discussion. Prof Chu, please.
Thank you, Jacqueline. Okay, so now we have come to the Q&A session. So I see that there are already quite a number of questions being asked. So perhaps let me start off with the first question to every speaker. So maybe perhaps according to what I see, right, we can start off with Mr. Goh first, followed by Dr. Satya and Dr. Lee Hao Bin and Dr. Fu Siu Jiu. So the question is, what are some of the challenges in implementing AI technology into a company business processes? Mr. Goh?
Yeah, that's quite a good question. So in NCS, we do work with our clients to help them in their AI and analytics journey. So I just highlight some of the few challenges that I see for most of the company that I experience, I deal with, right? So just to highlight probably three or four challenges. In my view, probably the first one would be identifying new cases, use cases, right? So you can't adopt AI just because everyone is doing it, right? The business users and IT guys must come together to identify possible use cases which will meet the users, the business objectives, or solve the organization's pain point, right? So with relevant use cases identified, you know, without any relevant use cases identified, then it is challenging for the organization to kickstart the analytics or AI journey. And second is about probably understanding the benefits of AI, right? So quantifying the benefits of AI projects sometimes could be difficult. Of course, you know, some benefits could be very well defined, such as a revenue increase or time save, but there may be other areas, that may be difficult to quantify, for example, customer experience, right? So, but ultimately, you must be able to somehow try to quantify the benefits of AI, right? Third, I think probably will be the lack of strategic approach to AI adoption. So to get management support, AI initiative need to be planned at a strategic level, right? So lack of a strategic approach means the plan failed to meet to address the strategic business objective and don't fit within the organization overall plan, right? So the other barrier, the other challenges could be lack of AI analytics skill sets in the organization or cultural barrier, right? So these are the few things I'd like to highlight. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Kwan Heng. So actually, what Kwan Heng had mentioned is quite important, especially I noticed that for a company to adopt AI, one of the important criteria is that the company must have skilled people who are able to AI. I think this is one of the important criteria among other things that Kwan Heng had mentioned. Dr. Sayamuti, any other points that you want to make?
Yeah, I agree with what Mr. Goh has said just now. I think having a well-crafted problem statement is frequently the biggest challenge I personally face internally. I think everyone gets excited, but when it comes down to, you know, identifying exactly where the AI should intervene in the business process, I think that is one of the challenges. I think appreciation of AI is something we are also focused on, because with that education, I think people get better at this. I think you already mentioned the need to have a good skill base of AI engineers or data analytics folks. I think on top of that, I think collecting and sharing good quality data, because as I mentioned earlier, this wave of AI is really built on top of data analytics or data. So I thought that is one of the key ingredients we need to pay attention as well.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, as what you mentioned, it's important that, you know, we don't just adopt AI for the sake of adopting AI. I mean, our company needs to know what they are used for and what how can they solve their problem. I think that is important. That is what actually both Dr. Sayamuti and Kwan Heng have actually mentioned. Pass to Dr. Li Haobin. So any inputs from you?
Yeah, I think maybe a simple answer from me for this is actually the lack of data, but I will say that this will not be the root reason. Okay, I think the root cause is actually the lack of the standards for people to exchange information. Or maybe if we take this as an example, I mean, if we want to deploy a one AI solution for industry, we need an AI engineer. We need an AI engineer, and also we need an expert who know the domain knowledge. But it will be a little bit more difficult for us to identify a person who are actually expert in both, right? So that we need a certain interface. Either we want to let the AI person to understand the industry, or we need the industry people to be able to understand the AI expert. So if we're able to have certain kind of the standard for them to exchange information, to describe the problems, then I think it will actually accelerate this progress. So yeah, actually, this is what I see.
Okay, Dr. Fu Siu-Ju, any other input from you?
Yeah, thanks for the earlier speakers sharing. I think the industry partner, they have their clear view about what's the challenges for the business process. But from my understanding, I think AI is a new thing. Yeah, and we need adopt or say allow a learning curve to be there. So it's not immediately you put some data, you put efforts, you'll get something out. It's not a crystal ball like that way. All of the, maybe from management level, from the middle layer, from the work level, so we need to learn. And also definitely like Haobin mentioned, data, whether we have sufficient information there, we allow the data to be accumulated, we allow the knowledge to be built up. I think allow multiple tries. Don't be afraid of the failure. I think that way we will see the destination of the successfulness in AI. Yeah, that's my view. Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, so I guess both Dr. Li Haobin and Dr. Siju have mentioned something that's important about the lack of data or the quality of data, which if the data is no good, you know, at the end of the day, it's very difficult to do learning in this space. Okay, so now I have some questions from the floor from Koji Sikumizu. He asked a question on how AI application to big data collected in SOMS, S-O-M-S. For example, could assist IMO's rule making process for safety, environmental protection and efficiency of navigation. So could I maybe address this question to Dr. Fu Siju, since they are doing maritime traffic safety?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, so I think a lot of data, including AIS data, is available for these SOMs. Yeah, so definitely it can help us describe the traffic go through Singapore Strait, go through Malacca Strait. So I think definitely we can better utilize such kind of big data, tame it. A lot of applications, for example, traffic hotspot ahead, whether we are experiencing some dense traffic, whether there are some risk ahead like piracy, right? That's a big challenge for our areas. So, and others like search and rescue. And even we can think a lot further like maritime supply chain. If some vessel carrying the cargoes but going to be spoiled, then whether we can allow them to do something in Port of Singapore or in other part of the SOMS to solve this supply chain problem. So I think a lot of applications can be done. And part of that from safety aspect, whether virtual traffic light can be applied, some kind of a warning like what we see in the Google Map can be applied by IMO. I think it's a long-term things to go. Yeah, definitely, yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Fu Siju. So actually, we can see that there is a lot of opportunity, I mean, using AIS data to help to provide advice on the safety and also able to do some sort of a study on environmental protection and efficiency for navigation, especially to help in the policy making. Yeah, I think that is interesting. So I have another question from Yi Wei Lo, and he mentioned that there is a great emphasis on port and infrastructure AI, and to have a complete ecosystem, in your view, would there be a next phase of AI to be pushed to end users such as vessels, ship owners, ship agents, so the optimization can be further enhanced? So I think this question I can direct to Dr. Satyamurthy, is because just now in your presentation, you mentioned about PSA going beyond just port operators, right?
Yeah, thanks, Prof. Chu. And indeed, I noticed the question was posted before I began the presentation. So I think definitely there is a scope for going beyond the port operations. And I think as a community system, Portnet has been around for many years now. I think this is somewhat innovative, I think, when it was first started here. But I think we are even going beyond our local port community. I think now it's really about finding our rightful place in the global supply chain. I think you can see when disruptions happen, I think multiple disruptions have happened in the last 1 year or so. I think you can really see there is opportunity to find alternative ways of routing the cargo. A lot of times, you know, a transshipment port like Singapore happens to be the key. I mean, the way we facilitated the shipping lines or the cargo owners or the container operators to, you know, find alternative ways of sending the cargo, I think definitely we facilitate this. But now I think the future is really about not just looking at disruptions, but overall, I think improving the efficiency, even in good times. And I think that is important because of environmental factors, which I mentioned as well. I think everyone is now trying to implement some kind of a carbon calculator. They want to know how much did I add to the carbon footprint by routing this way or passing through this port. I think all these are areas which require a lot of data to be shared, you know, which can be trusted, because if you're going to claim credit for carbon emission reduction, it must be verified and stuff like that. So I thought it's not really the AI technique which is lacking. I think it's really about finding the proper use case and then sharing the data around that, I think, which will allow us to make the next push, yeah, which I'm very hopeful is going to happen.
Yeah, I think I agree with Dr. Satya's comment. I think these questions is about, you know, how to optimize the port ecosystem, right? So ships is the main customer of the port, but when the ship arrives, it is not just unloading and loading of cargo, right? It comes here, you need to send a pilot on board, you need a tugboat to serve them. The ship also need to take a bunker, you need to take a ship supply, take water, right? So all these service provider, they want to optimize their resources, but how do you optimize the resources that at the same time to minimize the ship stay, right? Then this is about sharing of data among all the key stakeholders. Everyone need to know what is the change of the ETA. Everyone need to know what is the service required time for the various service provider. Then they work towards the optimization of the resources, at the same time try to give the minimum inconvenience to the ships. So sharing of data within the stakeholders will be the first step that you need to push it through. Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Satyamurthy and Mr. Goh Kuan Heng, for a very good answer. So essentially, we know that actually for today's era, especially Industry 4.0, data are now available everywhere. And so there is actually opportunity for companies to come together to share data so that they can actually increase or improve their productivity. And this is where actually I learned from Dr. Fu Xiuju, that just actually actually introduced this term called federated learning, which is quite interesting. Yeah. So actually, I think this is one of them. Okay, I have a next question from Vetpal Aya, okay? He asked a question in a live, real life scenario. Sorry, my question is moving around. In a real life scenario, data come from different systems that are from different regions around the world. So synchronization of these systems will be challenging task. Any insights on how such a challenge can be overcome? So maybe for this question, I will direct to Dr. Li Haobin.
Yeah, actually our center have been looking into this issue as because we want to build a port digital team. We want our simulator is able to synchronize with a port. So actually we have been thinking into this problem. So how can we define this synchronization? Yeah, for example, maybe people just say you just observe what's happening in the real time, just copy the data here. We think this is not enough because I mean some of the data we can see is actually related to, for example, the design configuration of the system. So such kind of data will be there, okay, for a long time. No change, then maybe we can call the static data. Some of the data is actually dynamically changing, right? You observe at a different time, those information changed. Okay, so this is another category of the data. For example, we call this a dynamic data. Then maybe there's another portion. We can see this is actually the trigger for the change of those dynamic data. This is also important. For example, the arrival of the vessel, right? So when this happens, then we see the state will change, the dynamic information will change. So I think one of the possible ways is that we need to carefully looking into the data and classify them into the different category so that not only a human being but a machine is able to understand and digest. And according to such kind of the standard, then we zoom into the different industry, for example, into the port, into the warehouse. So at least these are the two areas our center is doing, and also maybe some other business, some other like industrial domains. Then we can actually zoom into each of the industrial cluster, then to see that what are these three different, or even like more than three different like aspect of the data really mean in this, in those industrial cluster. Then we get a consensus from the different like stakeholders in such industrial cluster. Then we can make it a standard. Then the next time when we come out to say we want to exchange the data, we want to achieve certain synchronization, then we can just refer to like a certain standard. Then everyone will know what does this mean. So this standard can be built between the industry and maybe researcher, can also be built between the like a physical system and the machine, the AI algorithm. Yeah, so I think this is actually one of the agenda that our center is pursuing. And I think this is also like very related to this so-called port ML that we are doing in our center. Yeah, so this is our approach.
Okay, Dr. Li Haobin, for giving a good answer. So perhaps there's another question by Mrs. Xia. He mentioned that an ideal situation seems to be one where every single container is identified by, say, IoT, like what OOCL has done for reefers. I cannot imagine how optimization can be proficiently accomplished without it. So is there any comments from the floor? Anyone would like to take this question?
I guess I agree with comments from Mr. Xia. I mean the optimal situation is that every container should have a sensor to be an IoT device, right? So you can track the location, you can track the temperature for the reefer container like OCL. But I think this issue about who pay for the IO devices for every devices that attach to the container have been discussed for many years. Right, so that's the issue. So you end up that maybe you only use IoT device for containers that is of high value or perishable good, right? That's why OOCL only put in IoT device for the customers and for the reefer container, right? So I think I don't think it's about technology issue, but it's a business issue, right? Who pay for the cost? Right. Is it the shippers? Is it the shipping line, or is it the port operator? Right. So this is the issue. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Kon Heng. Yeah. So eventually, yeah, you're right. I mean, it's a business decision. You know, at the end of the day, whether if they invest in this kind of technology, will they benefit out from it? I think that is the key question. Okay. I have another question. Which is the last question for today, since we are running out of time, from Jaya Vera Pandian, Kumar Ravel, okay. Whether port community systems play any role in AI of port operations? Also, can you explain whether these AI solutions should consider external user behaviors? So maybe I can direct this question to Dr. Sayamuthi.
Yes, thanks. I'm not sure I got the question correctly, but let me try. And I think definitely the port community systems should be play a part, because I think they facilitate the sharing of data itself. I mean, all the presence of the stakeholders, I think, allows the data to flow efficiently and all that. And the other part about the behavior of the external users, I think it really depends on the context. I think to the extent that the behavior of the external users impacts port operations, I think definitely we will try to do that. For example, Mr. Goh had mentioned the ship suppliers, right? So we know that they need to deliver the ship supplies to the ship. It can be ship stores or stuff for the crew and all this. But when they come to the ship side, definitely there are operations ongoing as well. And you need to deconflict, for example. So if they just come at any point of time, either we have to make allowance for them or they have to wait for the operations to finish before they can go in. So I think we do need to reckon with their behavior. Another place where I think we deal with their behavior is, you know, the haulage truckers who bring the containers in and out. I think definitely we see that, for example, start of the day, a lot of them will come at the same time. So this does affect port operations because there can be congestion, and in the end it inconveniences not only the haulier truckers, but also the other port users as well. So to that extent, definitely yes. But if you're asking about benefits to someone outside the port, I think these applications, I think, are yet to, you know, take shape. Yeah. I'm not saying that they're already there. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Sayamuthi. So actually, we can see that there's a lot of opportunity out there, especially once when we are able to deploy AI in our own internal business process. Then I guess the next step forward is to actually see how we could actually put all this AI technology together as an ecosystem, you know, where we talk about sharing of data and how we could benefit each of the companies that is involved in this maritime ecosystems to move a container, let's say, from one port to the other port. Yeah. So, okay. So this comes to the end of the Q&A session. Thank you. And for those questions that we have not answered, I believe we will post it to the speakers and they will be able to on the site, right, Jacqueline?
That's right. That's right.
So before we end this webinar, I think there are some takeaways I can see from this talk. So maybe I'd like to share some of them. So from Dr. Li Haobing's presentation, he has actually mentioned that having a good AI technology will require learning from optimized decision than any decision or suboptimal decision derived from scenarios or data. So after all, you know, learning is based on regressing decision with the set of data. And so if you try to correlate data with bad decisions, at the end of the day, your AI will not work, right? So this is quite obvious. And able to generate future data from simulations, and not only historical data, will actually help learning to be more effective. And then from Dr. Fusiju, some of the things that I captured from her talk is that data available, privacy and security, the quality of the data, computing resources, and federated learning are some of the important successful ingredients for implementing AI. And from Quan Heng, he has shared that it is actually inevitable for companies to adopt digital technology such as analytics and data-driven and AI, for them to position themselves stronger to compete in the maritime space. I mean, there is no one size fit all, and companies will need to understand the problem and customize the AI technology according to that need. And the window opportunity is short, and so for companies to be able to exploit it. And from Dr. Sayamuthi, what I have get from him is, we see that port operators are now looking beyond port operations activities such as cargo, providing cargo solutions, supply chain efficiency, developing platform for supply chain efficiency and automation and digitalization. I guess ports operators are now seeing that they have to look beyond just the port operating operations to better make their port more efficient and also to look for new business models. And this is where the opportunity for applying AI comes in. And also, and Dr. Syed Muti also has shown many successful use cases which have applied AI and data-driven methodology, resulting in good productivity or cost minimization in their processes, which is one of the good, many good use cases that Dr. Syed Muti has shown. So that is potential use of AI to actually improve the port operations. So thank you very much. Jacqueline, I pass back to you.
Yes. Thank you, Prof. Chu. And thank you to all the speakers and panelists. It was indeed a very interactive, very stimulating discussion. And to our audience, thank you for your active participation in today's session. Due to time constraints, we do apologize that we are not able to address all the questions today. And we will try to consolidate the answers to the question, and then we will do a post-event coverage, which will be made available on the SMI website. So we have come to the end of today's webinar. Thank you once again for joining us. Till we next meet, do take care and stay well. Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Bye.